Good morning, Ted.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. We just want to thank you for listening to the message of today. Hopefully that everyone is okay and you are able to hear me clearly. Let us have a call to worship. Come embrace the risen Christ. Come embrace the Prince of Peace. Come embrace his pierced hands. Come meet your Lord and your God. Amen.
John 20, 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. We are the people of God. Risen Lord, as we gather today, we may see you and hear you. We may feel you and touch you. We may know your presence with us. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for people who are alone, for people who feel lonely, people who don't know what a loving hug feels like. We pray that you will come and close to them and bring them into your presence. As the disciples in the locked room reached out and touched you, let us reach out and touch you today, living Lord, as we are in our locked houses, under lockdown. We feel we are nearly the same as the disciples in the upper room. Let us feel your scared hands and feet. Let us put our hands in your side. Let us be still and know that you are our Lord and God. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to have this. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, I've decided to share with you on the theme, From Fear to Overflowing Joy, coming from the book of John chapter 20, verse 19 to 31. Fear is the very opposite of faith to which Christ has called us. Today's lesson from John's Gospel tells us that on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. We can identify with these anxious, fearful disciples of Jesus. Even right now, at this present moment, we are so anxious, so fearful of the coronavirus. Our doors are locked. We can't allow anyone to come near us. After all, it was the Sunday evening following Jesus' crucifixion. This had been a traumatic weekend for these disciples. Can we blame them for hovering nervously in the upper room? The doors were shut, says John, for fear of the Jewish leaders. That's what we are hearing. How tragic it is anytime the doors of the church are shut because of fear. There was a time when many churches in this land were never logged. People would go from anywhere, would come from anywhere and come and enter into the church. Church doors were never locked. Few churches would risk that today. We fear that someone would carry the church away. We fear that someone would steal, would do something to our church. There were other doors that were shut too. However, in those allegedly golden days of old, when many of us were growing up, there were doors, for example, that were shut against people of other races. Where people would want to worship not with mixed race. Where people would, where churches were not multiracial. How tragic it is when fear, which is at the heart of any prejudice, shuts the doors of the church. How tragic it is when fear shuts the doors of a person's heart. That happens to people too. When you shut your heart from other people, you don't want to talk to them. You don't want even to, you can't even smile at anyone because you have shut the doors of your heart from other people. They draw into their own private worlds because something out there is just too threatening. How about you? Are you living behind closed doors because of fear? One reason the disciples were hiding behind closed doors may have been the proliferation of rumors in Jerusalem at the time of Jesus' crucifixion. John says that the disciples were behind closed doors because of fear of the Jewish leaders. There's no indication in the scriptures that such fears were justified. Nothing. Nothing. There's no evidence that the violence of that terrible weekend went beyond the torture, the death of Jesus. But surely there were rumors. There's no evidence that the violence of that terrible weekend went beyond the torture and death of Jesus. But surely there were rumors. It's always that way. Whenever there's conflict between rival groups, rumors fly. Fear escalates. Reason is suspended. We don't reason. We now live by our emotions. And that is what is happening. That is what is happening again. Sometimes the results of such rumors are relatively mild. In February 2020, there were repeated rumors that had been making the rounds in local newspapers that local stores were running out of supply of toilet papers due to the COVID-19. You want to guess what happened? Millions of shoppers ran out and stocked up on extra toilet paper just in case the rumor was true. It was a national phenomenon. Just the rumor of a possible toilet paper shortage almost led to a real toilet paper shortage all over the Australia, if not the world. Because that was a rumor which was moving on. Rumors can sometimes provide us with a self-fulfilling prophecy. Rumors fly that the country is running out of a toilet paper, and because of the fear endangered by the rumor, people start buying it up, and soon the country nearly does run out of toilet paper. Sometimes, however, the power of idle rumors can have much more tragic consequences. And that is what it is. Idle rumors can ruin a life. They can start a rebellion. They can trap good people behind closed doors because of fear. There was no evidence that the Jewish leaders intended any harm to Jesus' followers. But there were rumors, and that was enough to destroy the sense of well-being for those first followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. They could stand. They could go out. Because they were afraid. But it was because of rumor. It was all because of rumor. We should be able to identify with those early disciples. There is much fear in our society today. That fear is often fed by rumor. We have perfected the rumor mill in our society. We have the press. No paper or television station wastes ink or airtime on good news. Bad news is good news for the nation's media. Every individual is now a journalist. A steady stream of bad news feeds many people's ears. Go on all sort of social media platforms. Facebook, YouTube, anything you may think of. And most of the things that we are receiving is just fake news. And we have blogs on the internet, many of them characterized by fake news, that are dedicated to stoking people's fears as well. Fear can be so irrational. Did you know, for example, that you are 11 times more likely to die from stroke than to be murdered because of fear? If we were so careful to watch our diet as we are to lock our doors at night, we would be able in much better shape. The disciples were hovering behind locked doors, first of all, because of the proliferation of rumors. Rumors were moving so fast. That's why they were behind doors. In the second place, they were hovering behind closed doors because they had temporarily misplaced their faith. They were not atheists or agnostics that Jesus had recruited. They were not religious scholars by any means, but they were surely had some familiarity with the Psalms. They probably grew up reciting, "The Lord is my shepherd," in their synagogues. But on this day, they were hiding behind closed doors. What does that tell us? They were familiar with Joshua and Moses and other heroes of the Old Testament. They knew that the Lord was the rock of their salvation, who would never forsake them. Where was their faith now? The faith that had sustained them from the time they were infants. Where was their faith? Besides, they had been with Jesus. Some of them for 3 years. How many times had Jesus told them not to be afraid? Someone has noted that there are 366 fear not in the Bible. 366 fear not verses in the Bible, one for each day of the year and an extra one for the leap year. Had not any of it rubbed off on them? A time of crisis came and they had gone back to acting as they did before Jesus ever called them to follow. Where was their faith? Where was their faith? It's like that small boy who was riding a bus home from Sunday school. He was very proud of the card he had received that day in class, which had a picture and a caption that read, "He had faith in God." Then to his dismay, the card slipped through from his hand and fluttered out the window. "Stop the bus," cried the boy. "I've lost my faith in God." The driver pulled the bus to a stop. And as the boy climbed out and went to retrieve his card, one of the adults riders smiled and made a comment about the innocent young boy. A more perceptive adult observed, "All of us would be better off if we were that concerned about our faith." Under stress, something like that often happens to us. We temporarily misplace our faith and go back to acting as if we had never heard the gospel. We do this even though we know that faith is our greatest ally. Those who trust in God and just God never lose hope. They are perennial optimists. Such faith not only makes us easier to live with, but is also of great benefit in dealing with some of our greatest fears. And that's what we need. I'll tell you a story about Henry Ward Beecher. Once said, "Every day has two handles. We can take hold of it when the hand of anxiety and the hand of faith. So the disciples had hold of the hand of anxiety. So they were hiding behind closed doors because of the proliferation of unfounded rumors. They were hiding because they had temporarily misplaced their faith. Principally, however, they were hiding behind closed doors because they felt abandoned. Abandoned by whom? By their Lord. There was something about the presence of the Master that gave them a sense of calm, even in the presence of imminent danger. There was that time that he calmed the storm and walked out to the boat where they were huddled. The first words he spoke were, "Fear not, it is I." So they would know who that is with us. He's with them. Where was he now? Crucified. Body stolen from the tomb. Absent from them in flesh and in spirit. They were sheep without a shepherd. Children whose parents had abandoned them and left them to face the cold, cruel world on their own. Things were not okay. I read one of the psychologists who says, one of the greatest fears of childhood, parents leaving children in the church nursery for the first time have to give their children a lot of reassurance, "I'm coming back. Stay well, I'm coming back. In a short time I will be back." Deep in the hearts of many children is the fear that their parents are never coming back. That fear continues with us over our lifetime, even when we are adults. This is one of the most crippling results of divorce on some children. Why has dad abandoned me? Does he love me anymore? Teenagers have much of the same devastation when called upon to handle the death of a parent. We are usually not aware of it, but that emotion stays with us through our entire lives. A new widow or a widower will often have an overwhelming sense of abandonment. Such is also the experience of life without God. But God has not abandoned his people. He still has got his people. So the story about a small village in Poland during the days of the Nazi came to town. It was on a Sunday, and the people were in church and worshiping when troops of the Third Reich swung into the village. The soldiers entered the church and ordered everyone outside. Then the troops set fire to the structure. Then the soldiers pointed their weapons at the congregation. But instead of shrinking in fear, these people began to sing, "A mighty fortress is our God." Remember, it was a German, Dr. Martin Luther, who wrote this hymn. The people in the congregation, as well as the German soldiers, grew up singing this hymn. So the people sang a verse and then went on to the next verse, waiting for the bullets. They truly expected that rifle fire would stop their singing. But the bullets didn't come. Finally, looking around at the German soldiers surrounding them, they were astonished to see guns lowered and every hardened Nazi face streaming with tears. The soldiers, one by one, two by two, slowly turned and climbed back into their trucks and jeeps. They pulled away from their little town. The soldiers left behind a congregation of the faithful, standing outside their burning church singing. The disciples huddled behind closed doors because they felt abandoned. But they were not abandoned. Listen, here is the good news. Christ can penetrate the closed doors of our lives. Christ can penetrate the closed doors, even of our houses right now, when we are in shutdown. Christ can enter, he's there with you. Fear not, for Christ is there with you. Listen to the reading from John's Gospel once. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. There is the best antidote I know to the fear that so easily besets us. It is experience the presence of the risen Christ, to see the marks of his love for us in the hands and sight to hear his say, as he said to those early disciples, peace be with you. Peace be with you, brothers and sisters. We may not see God around us. We may not see the wounds in Jesus' hands and sight the way Thomas needed to see. We may not hear Jesus' voice in real time. We may not see him face to face in the way his disciples did when he walked his earth so long ago. But doesn't mean his power isn't there. Like our invisible enemy, COVID-19, Jesus' power is there. Jesus appears to us in our loved homes, in our distress, in the most astonishing, loving, healing, creative ways we can possibly imagine, filling us with hope, placing words of wisdom and proclamation into our mouth, bolstering us up so that we can create peace and joy even in the midst of a changing world. I'm talking of a changing world. This world is changing now because of the coronavirus. Jesus did many signs to tell us that signs that were never even recorded in the gospel. But what was recorded was done so you believe that Jesus is Messiah, God's Son. You may have life in his name. So this is recorded for you and me. Jesus is still doing miracles around us. Just look at the energy of every first responder. Just look at the vitality of your online churches now. How many people now are visiting your website? How many people are going into YouTube listening to the word of God on a daily basis? Just look at the inspiration of your celebrities and heroes. Just look at the unity of the world united against the common enemy, coronavirus. Look at it. God's spirit is alive and kicking. And so we are. In this Easter time, may you continue to be uplifted, engaged, energized, and sent. I wish you creativity, joy, and hope, and impetus to make your faith count, to invest in your future and in others. Isn't that great? Isn't that what we are looking for? Often we don't invest in change until change is forced upon us. We don't like change until change is forced upon us. Today, a virus is changing the world as we know it with what we might call forced innovation. Maybe some people are talking, saying, why don't we have online messages? People say, no, we can't do that. We can't do that. Why can we not worship somewhere outside the church? No, we can't leave our church buildings. But now we are forced. We are out of our comfort zone. It's because of change. Coronavirus has forced us to change. Right now, people all over the world are engaging social media, communications, relationship, heroism, philanthropy to a degree nearly unprecedented. People are now communicating like never before. You find that people are now calling, they are calling their long-time relatives they have never spoken to 2 years ago, in more than 2 years, but now they are calling them. Why? Because there's change. Something has happened. We are afraid of loneliness. The human spirit rises to the occasion when threatened or trembled. Human creativity soars by growing new wings the moment our wings are clipped. God's spirit infuses us with life, hope, and love, and compassion, even peace at the times when we must grieve. And that is what we are. Today, as in the days of the first apostles, our greatest and most valuable commodity is not gold, or money, or equipment, or even cure, but faith in God. And in ourselves, in our future, and in our human propensity for compassion and sacrificial love. That is what is needed. Jesus did not promise his disciples that things would go back to the way they were before. But things did happen. Nothing was going to change that. But Jesus assured them that even better things would happen now if only they would go forward and proclaim him risen. He's alive. Jesus sent his disciples out in the most scroliest of times to heal those afflicted with doubt and grief, to encourage those who felt all was lost, to lift up those who felt dismayed, to give hope to the dying, to proclaim victory to those whose faith was faltering. Jesus is calling us to do the same. He's calling us to do the same. They would be guided by God's power, fueled by their faith. But first, they would need to enter boldly into a brave new world, a different world, a changed world, to be stability in a culture in flux. Things are no longer the same. We need to preach a different gospel. In this time of Easter, may you continue to be uplifted, engaged, energized, and sane. I wish your creativity, joy, hope, and impetus to make your faith count, to invest in your future and others. For in a world when monetary investments are lost and material things are scarce, tissues are now becoming a special commodity. Relationships are everything. Human life, eternal life means anything. Gold is for holding. Faith is for sharing. We can't hold our faith. We have to share our faith with everyone we meet. May God's blessing be upon you. Or as Jesus said to his disciples in that locked room, peace be with you. Peace be with you under the lockdown. Peace be with you when you are on your own. Peace be with you with your own family. Peace with you in your fear. And realize that Jesus is alive. He's alive. My God is alive. He's alive. He's there. He's alive. Let us celebrate together, knowing that I'm not on my own, but God is with me. May the good Lord bless you from now and evermore. Amen. Let us close our service as we pray, knowing that God is there for us. Let us pray. Lord, thank you that in your presence is fullness of joy, that in you we find life. You lead us throughout our lives, always beside us, always faithful to us. Go before us now, and we may bring joy to our world, the world which is under fear, the world which is troubled, the world which has been traumatized. Father, we pray that you continue to show that you are the one in control. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, may it continue to abide with you. In Jesus' name, Amen.